Hello, everybody. Happy September for our first Facebook Global Travel Update for the month. And happy fall. Peter Greenberg here with you. And of course, earlier this week, I posted on Facebook a picture to see if anybody could guess where we were going to come from this week. It was a picture of an island with some boats on a beach. And I asked you guys to tell me where I was. And a couple of you almost got it right. You technically had it right, but I'll tell you where it was, and I'll tell you where I am. Where that picture was taken just 2 days ago is Pemba Island. If anybody knows where that is, it's actually in the Zanzibar archipelago of Tanzania. So some of you guessed Zanzibar, so you were sort of right, but I was actually on Pemba, an amazing location. Talk about blue economy and sustainable ecotourism. These guys have got it down. I'm over here right now because I'm right now tonight in 7 hours ahead of New York in Dar es Salaam in Tanzania, where we are doing my 1 hour global television special called The Royal Tour. Some of you know we've been doing that for about 20 years with heads of state. So I'm here with the president of Tanzania, and she is my tour guide. We'll be shooting for the next 8 days all around the country. And so hopefully you'll see that in January, February on PBS. If you haven't seen the other ones we've done, we've been doing them really for the last 20 years, starting with the King of Jordan, the Prime Minister of New Zealand, the President of Mexico, President of Ecuador, Prime Minister of Jamaica, Prime Minister of Israel, and President of Rwanda, Prime Minister of Poland, and many others, and now the President of Tanzania. So more information on that as we get further along, but I just want to let you know where we are, and that's where we are. If you got some comments, please send them in. You can always email me at any time to peter@petergreenberg.com with your name, phone number, question, or problem. We will answer it either live here or on our radio show, Eye on Travel, which you'll hear every Saturday on CBS. And if you can't find it in your local market, that's not a problem. Just go right to our website with the imaginative name, petergreenberg.com. And you can hit the radio icon. We stream it live every Saturday from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. Eastern time. If you want to follow me on Twitter, it's @PeterSGreenberg. Instagram is @PeterGreenberg. But right now we are Facebooking it with you. And let's talk about the news. You heard the announcement, which is a very confusing announcement earlier this week, that the European Union is recommending that its 27 member states reinstate travel restrictions on Americans coming to Europe. Nobody knows what that means, but I can tell you what it doesn't mean. It is not a rule, it is not a regulation, it is not a law, it's a non-binding recommendation. And if you're vaccinated, you're already ahead of the game. I'll give you, and it's up to individual of these 27 states, individual states to either opt in or opt out. The decisions have to be made before this coming Monday. Already we've seen some countries make those decisions. Italy is now saying, if you're a vaccinated American, of course you can still come. You're just going to have to show a negative COVID ID test, negative COVID test, 72 hours before you get there, even if you're vaccinated. I think we can all do that. And we'll hear the other countries weighing in over the next 96 hours. We'll obviously stay on top of that. Now, why did they do it? They claimed it was because of the rise in COVID cases in the U.S. But that makes no sense, because these countries are already open to only vaccinated Americans, not unvaccinated Americans. If you're an unvaccinated American, it's getting tougher and tougher and tougher for you to have a normal life, let alone travel. And my prediction is by Thanksgiving, you won't be able to go to the grocery store without showing proof of vaccination, or the dry cleaner, or the movie theater, or a Broadway play. We've seen it in an internal way with the airlines and some other companies basically saying if you're not vaccinated, you no longer have a job, right? United Airlines basically says, if you're not vaccinated by the 25th of this month, if you're an employee there, and that's 67,000 employees, by the way, you're gone. Delta's saying, oh, it's okay if you don't want to be vaccinated, but we're charging you a $200 a month surcharge for the health costs we know we're going to get hit with when you get the virus. So the economic consequences here are really putting the squeeze on the non-vaccinated. So not a political issue, an economic one. It goes back, remember the days of smoking and no smoking on airlines when they wanted to get rid of smoking Everyone says you'll never be able to pull it off. They won't stand for it. Not only did it happen, and not only did every court uphold the rights to do that as a public health issue, there was even an attempt somewhere about 20 years ago to start an all-smoking airline on the airlines, right? An all-smoking airline, and it lasted about 3 days because even the smokers didn't want to be on a plane with other smokers. So let's see what happens here. But this is the direction we're going. And by the way, Ireland has refused to add any new restrictions for Americans. So the trend will continue that way. If you're a vaccinated American, you're still going to be able to go overseas. There may be one or two exceptions. But right now, the economic impact alone dictates that most countries are not going to make that move. So why did the EU even make the recommendation? Because they're pissed off. They're pissed off because the United States has not reciprocated and opened the door to vaccinated Europeans wanting to come to the U.S. And why is that? Because the Federal Drug Administration, the FDA, has not given approval to the AstraZeneca or the Sino vaccine. It's really as simple as that. And until that approval happens, or unless it happens, we're not opening the door. So this is just done to try to pressure the U.S. into maybe relaxing that restriction. So far, that hasn't happened. What has happened, though, is because of concerns about so many travelers about the Delta variant and the fact that it's like a perfect storm and a triple whammy. You have concerns about the Delta variant. You've got kids going back to school, right? We're in September now. We have no business travel really booming yet. And we have the third quarter coming up, which traditionally is a slower month or slower period. As a result, bookings are dropping off. Cancellations are rising because people can do that on U.S. carriers without losing their money anymore. And guess what? The numbers are way down. A few days ago, the TSA screened the fewest number of passengers since last May 11th. Not over 2.7 million, 1.35 million. And that was 33% less than the similar time period in 2019. And that's going to continue to trend downward. Now, is there a silver lining here? You bet. It's called buyer's market for people who want to be smart travelers and responsible travelers. The airfares are dropping precipitously. Now, normally they go down in September, but I haven't seen them go this far down. One airfare I was able to snag from Dallas to LaGuardia on American Airlines, a one-way ticket for September 13th. Usually a heavily traveled business route on American with very little discounting. My airfare, $49 one way. And if you break out the taxes on that ticket, American netted, I think, about $17. Obviously a loss leader, great for me. And great for you if you plan it properly. Now, some other crazy news. The U.S. State Department, they've had their hands full lately trying to get people out of countries. Well, one of the things they haven't been able to do successfully is get us out of the country. That is, of course, if you want a passport. So the backlog in passports and the delay in processing them, they're going to call this progress. They've gone from 6 months down to 4.5 months. That's how long it's going to take you through normal channels to get a passport. So let's get out the calendar. You're not traveling until 2022, if that holds. That's embarrassing, that's avoidable, and it just makes no sense. But those are the facts. They cannot get their act together. Now, there's some passport expediters that you can use that will get them faster, but you're going to have to pay for them. And that's a premium ticket price to get an expedited passport, just as long as you know that. And the airfares abroad are going down because that EU announcement didn't do wonders for international airline tickets. People are just going to say, I'm going to wait. And all of a sudden, you got empty planes going across oceans. So this is the time to plan ahead. You might want to think all the way through the end of December. Now, we know that there's the Wednesday before Thanksgiving. No news there. That's going to be expensive. We know that the Friday before Christmas, that's going to be expensive. No news bulletin there. But any other time between September 13th, that's a Monday, and the end of the year, go for it. You're in the driver's seat when it comes to buying tickets. So just know that. Okay, moving right along, We got to talk about my favorite topic, alcohol at airports, and I'll explain it. We all know that because of the mask mandate in the United States not expiring now until next January, airlines like American and Southwest are not bringing back booze until then. But one airline has gone a little further than that. That's American. They've convinced retailers, airport retailers, at a number of U.S. airports not to sell alcohol to go, because so many of their passengers are like pre-gaming the flight. They're doing everything short of tailgating, which means they get on the plane already tanked. You may have seen the viral video earlier this week about that American Airlines passenger at gate D23 in Miami going out of his mind and throwing stuff at counters, and all because he didn't want to wear a mask. He was just having a meltdown. You know, it's interesting. When I tell you the number of fines now being assessed and the amount of those fines, I mean, in the last 2 weeks, about 24 Americans have been fined over $535,000 by the FAA, not mentioning what they're going to have to go through if they ever want to fly again. I'm going to read you some of this stuff. It's worth it. Let me pull it up here. It's here. Give me a second. Okay. There's a woman on a JetBlue flight. She refused to mask up. Her fine, $29,000. Another JetBlue passenger fined, get ready for this one, $45,000 for not behaving, but doing something even worse, sticking his head up a flight attendant's skirt. Which airline was this? Oh, they didn't tell me the air. Oh, yes, Republic Airlines flight in Charlotte. She drank, she vaped, she refused the mask. She got hit with a $17,000 fine. And not to mention criminal penalties, it's not a good day in the airline business. But the idea that the airlines are finally getting smart and pressuring airport retailers not to sell booze to go is a good first step. I don't think it's the answer, but it's a good first step. I'm a huge believer in the NFL rules for the fourth quarter. I've talked about this for a couple of weeks now, that they should basically refuse to sell alcohol to anyone within 45 minutes of the boarding time printed on their boarding pass. It's a very simple solution there, and at least gives other passengers on the plane a reasonable chance of getting to their destination without somebody having a meltdown at 35,000 feet. So now let's go to some of your questions. Mike Lugan says a great suggestion. Thank you, Mike. Just fly first class, get all the booze you want. Okay, what seat will you be sitting in so I don't sit next to you? Thank you, Mike. Lynette says hello from Dallas. I also have a question about your thoughts on Japan opening. Right now, it really doesn't look like it's going to be opening for the next couple of months. If you take a look at Japan, Thailand, Korea, and then moving a little further south to Australia, New Zealand, we're talking 2022. It's a mess. Greg wants to know, what about the It's Easy app? You know what? I love the guys at It's Easy. They're a passport expediter, but they don't gouge you. They do not gouge you. You should check it out. The name of the company is It's Easy. I've been using them for years for all my visa needs. And believe me, I have visa needs. They will do whatever they can to help. And they've been doing a great job in the midst of all this craziness at the State Department. Here's one from Jane Kunmunchule. I hope I got that name right, Jane. Says, Dar es Salaam, the citizens are delightful. The citizens here are wonderful. You know, the welcoming spirit in Tanzania cannot be overstated. Everybody's happy, at least to see us. We've had just a tremendous time. If you've not been here before, and I know I'm going to anger some people out there when I say this, but I truly believe Tanzania is the way Kenya used to be. And I love Kenya too, but there's something so much more genuine these days about the experience in Tanzania, which hopefully we'll be able to share with you on our PBS special that'll be airing in January or February. All right, let's keep going down here. Sid is saying there's a no-fly list. I do hope they are putting these folks who cause problems on that list. Yes, but here's the question. If I get banned from American Airlines, what's going to stop me from flying United? What's going to stop me from flying Delta or Spirit or Frontier, or any other airline? Are the airlines sharing that information so that if you mess up on one airline, you can't go anywhere? That's, I think, a good answer to do it. Okay. Here we go. Oh, thank you, Jan. I got the name right. Let me scroll back up here. A lot of people to deal with tonight. Hello from Alabama. Katrina's on all the time. Evelyn's saying hi from the Rockies. Ah, my friend Peter, hello from Rwanda, our neighbor in Tanzania. That's right. We had a great time with Peter in Rwanda with the president when we did another royal tour special with President Paul Kagame. Patrick, I'm sure you're in LA. Good morning. Hello from Linda in the Villages. Okay. Mary Jane Rogers Phillips. Hi from MJ in Georgia. Mary Jane and I went to elementary school together and PS6 in Manhattan. So nice to see you. Big kiss to you, Mary Jane. Hey, from Bernice in Tanzania. And Bernice, lovely to hear from you. And thank you for all you've done in the past to get us here and to keep us here. And I hope I get a chance to see you. Mia says, good morning from Irvine, California. Diane says, what's happening to travel Japan? I just answered that question. There's Bernice again. Ah, Robin DiCarlo, hello from Williamsburg. And Jane says she loved Zanzibar. Think about the name Zanzibar. Doesn't it sound like the one Bob Hope Bing Crosby movie they should have made, right? The Road to Zanzibar. It's so exotic. It's so romantic. And by the way, it still is. If you've not been to Zanzibar, check out the beaches. Check out Stone Town. Check out those unbelievable architectural touches, the Arabic doors, the Indian influence, the Portuguese influence. It's amazing. People don't realize that Tanzania has been coveted by countries for years. It was originally called German East Africa, the name Tanganyika, right? The Germans had it. The Omanis had Zanzibar. Then the British, then the Portuguese came in. Then the British came in. And finally, in the window of 1961 to 64, there was a revolution here, and they got their independence. And they've been independent ever since. Colleen says, how in the world did people get so close to the answer? Oh, where I was? I don't know, but they guessed Zanzibar. They were almost there. We were on Pemba Island, which is part of the archipelago in Zanzibar. Okay, Anne wants to know, will the cruise lines ever accept medical letters for those who can't get vaccinations so they can travel? If you think so, when? This is going to settle out. It will settle out when the Florida law gets finally resolved. And once that happens, they will be making some accommodations. However, and I just want to warn you about this, Anne, you can bring a letter from your doctor, but and even if they accept you without being vaccinated, you're going to have to get tested every 2 days on the ship or whatever ship you're going to be on, and they will charge you $150 per test. That is the price you're going to have to pay to get on a ship and not being vaccinated. Okay. Ah, Lillian Turner says, would I please make rail suggestions traveling west before it gets too cold? Well, we were just on the Rocky Mountaineer. We loved that trip between Denver and Moab in Utah, from the Rockies to the Red Rocks. That's going to continue for another month till October, end of October. Of course, you can always take the Zephyr, which is Amtrak's train from Denver all the way up to California. In fact, we passed the Zephyr, or the Zephyr passed us, while we were on the Rocky Mountaineer. That's a great train. Okay. Here we go. Anne wants to know, what's our radio station on Saturday for the radio show? Just go to our website, because I don't have the list here. But if you can't find the station, just go right to our website, hit the radio icon, you'll hear the show, from wherever you happen to be in the world. Okay? Saturday from 10:05 a.m. to 1 p.m. New York time. Here's from Sandy Collins. In Charlotte, we leave for Italy in 5 days for 3 weeks. Vaxxed, got our PCR antigen test within 72 hours. All right, have a great time. And you're going at the best time. It's September in the Mediterranean. That's the magic month. Okay, here we are. Hold on a second. Hawaii update, please. Robin wants to know. I'm not going to give you the update because it changes by the hour. Right, the governor's already asked people not to come. Facilities are not really open. Restaurants are down at 25% capacity. It's a mess. And do what I've said before. If you want to go after October 15th. They will get this resolved. But right now, It's chaos. Okay. Mia says, I've never been to any country in Africa. Any suggestions on where to start for a solo woman traveler? Listen, there are 54 countries in Africa. 54. And I'm not worried for you as a solo woman traveler or anybody as a solo traveler, male or female, if you want to come to Tanzania. I'm not worried about Kenya. I'm not worried about Egypt in Northern Africa. Those would be three places to start. I'm a huge fan of Namibia. I'm a huge fan of Botswana. South Africa is just a little messy right now, not in terms of safety and security, just in terms of consistency. I'd wait about a month or two. And then, of course, you have the former Swaziland, which I love. Very small country, but great for that. And, you know, in South Africa, when you do go back, head to Cape Town. You will not be disappointed. Diane says hello from Daytona Beach. Hello, Diane. Okay. Okay, my grandpa, this is from Linda, says, my grandparents were both born in Calabria and came to America in 1909. If I were to buy a second home there, how easy or difficult is it to get there from Orlando? An expensive commute? Well, not if you do it right. Here's what I want you guys to do when you want to go and do this on a frequent basis, whether you're going to Calabria or not, or even from Orlando. And none of you do this. Go to a newsstand that sells British newspapers, especially the papers on Saturdays and Sundays. Get their travel sections. You're not going to find this online. And open the travel sections, and you'll see unbelievably great discounted fares from either Gatwick or Heathrow or Stansted or Luton to any of those other destinations in Europe, in Central Europe, even to the Middle East, to Malta, all the way south. They're all there. So the key is, don't book your flight as an expensive flight all the way there from the US. Get to a British gateway city inexpensively, and then book a second flight round trip from that British airport to where you want to go. And you'll find those deals on the travel section pages on a newspaper. Remember that? You pick it up in your hand, you read it. What a concept. You're not going to find it online. That's how you do it. All right. Gary wants to know, is a global vaccine pass the answer? You know what? I know Dr. David Agus. He and I both appear on CBS. Of course it's an answer. I've been yelling about that since day one. The problem is nobody's talking to each other. So there's no centralized set of standards to give you that globally accepted vaccine pass or passport that's easily verifiable, that's easily readable, that's easily updatable, and you can't forge. And right now, we're not seeing it, but what a great idea it can be. The technology exists. You just got to get everybody in the room, throw their egos at the door, just park them at the door, and national sovereignty doesn't count now. We're dealing with a global public health issue. That would be very helpful. Peter, any update on Argentina opening? Another sad case where they're just messed up. I've been trying to get to Argentina for nearly 2 years, and I'm hoping that by November they will. Their neighbor is opening now. That's Uruguay. And if Uruguay can open up, that's really going to anger the Argentinians. They want to be open. So October, November is my guess. Okay. Sandy says, I have intel that the Grand Egyptian Museum may not open in 2021. We are now going to Egypt in 2022. Any new info? Let me tell you, talk about chaos and confusion. We can't find an answer yet on when they're going to open up. And of course, if you go online, which is the worst thing you could do, by the way, look, the only reason why you want to go online is to find the phone number of the person who might have the answer. If you think the answer is online, you are delusional. And if you go online, you'll see that they say, oh, we're opening up next month. But they're not. So I promise you, Sandy, between now and next Thursday, some of my researchers will get killed if they don't know the right number to call, and we're going to get you that answer from somebody who's definitive about it, because I know, having talked to the Minister of Tourism of Egypt, they're desperate to open this museum, and for good reason. It's such an incredible museum, and remember what I told you to do once it's opened? Spend the $250 for the special, seriously amazing backstage tour where you're in the restoration rooms with the art, with the workers and the restorers. You are standing inches away from some of the most amazing archaeological discoveries, and they're doing it every single day. There are new things coming in that they're finding in the desert every single day. It's worth it, but we will get you that information on GEM. J.E. Kilgore said, how'd you find a theater like that? Okay, I'm going to fill you in on that. I looked online. I always go online first. Just because I want to see what I'm up against. And then I picked up the phone. What a concept. And I called the airline, right? And somebody picked up. What time did I call the airline? At 11:30 at night, not a push time. And there was that. And not only was there a $49 fare on the flight that I wanted early in the morning from Dallas to LaGuardia, every single flight that day on American from Dallas to LaGuardia, there were about eight of them, they were all $49. That tells you everything you need to know about the load factors of the airlines in September. Okay. Here's one from Jane who goes, oh, what do I think about CLEAR, the CLEAR program? I love it. I use it. I think these guys are great. They do a great job, not just at the airports now. They do a great job at sporting events and music venues. They've done a great job in Hawaii to get you cleared with all the changing regulations. Every chance I get at every airport CLEAR is at. Now, they're not at all the airports, but they're the big major ones. I use it. It's $179 a year. However, if you have an American Express Platinum card, I believe the Chase Sapphire card may also weigh in on this. They give you such a rebate that it's essentially free. Check it out. Do it. Okay. Oh, do I believe that the e-visa tendency will continue to spread? I do. A number of countries have electronic visas, Australia being one of the first to have them, and many other countries are logging in. I think it's great. However, I don't care whether you get an e-visa or not. Please do yourself a favor when you get that certification or confirmation that you've gotten the e-visa, hit the print button on your computer. You want to carry a paper copy. You want that thing to hold up because I don't trust phones. I don't trust tablets. I trust paper. That's your backup, okay? Okay. Anna wants to know if I've used the Abbott COVID test kit. I haven't. I get my vaccinations from the New York City Department of Health, and I think Walgreens gave me one of them, and I'm coming up to a booster pretty soon. One note about vaccinations, by the way, there are some countries like Switzerland that if you were vaccinated more than 6 months ago, they won't let you in. So talk to your doctor. See if it's appropriate for you to get another vaccination if you want to go to Switzerland. But you should check with every country you want to go to make sure they haven't snuck in that six-month requirement, because now if you're vaccinated in June, you're in. But if you're vaccinated like I was in February, you got a problem. So make sure you know. Okay, if you change planes at Heathrow, you need a negative COVID test. Thank you for that, Nancy. I appreciate that. Everybody right now with the changing rules in the EU, by the way, London is not part of the EU anymore, all you Brexit fans, doesn't matter. Get your negative COVID test within 72 hours before leaving the United States anyway, even if you're double vaccinated, just so you can show it, okay? All right. Here's one from James. I'm fully vaxxed and planning a trip to Germany this fall. My concern is picking up a breakthrough infection while overseas, delaying return and resulting in quarantine. Do you have a handle on how often is this happening? It's not happening very often at all. But I understand what you're saying, because there's been a subtext about so many Americans saying, I want to go here so badly, but I don't want to get stuck and not get home. That's what they were saying before the vaccines, during the pandemic. But James, I have no idea about your pre-existing medical condition, your age, your weight, et cetera, et cetera. But if you've been double vaxxed, check with your doctor and wear a mask, right? Do your negative tests as often as you can, as practically often as you can. And at least if your doctor says you can then go. Okay, here we go. Let's scroll down here. Give me a second. Lots more coming in. Coming down here. Hello, Roseanne from Lake Worth. We have a, here's one from Jim. We have a trip booked to Brazil in December. Hopefully we won't have any issues. Just, Brazil's a mess, guys. I hope you're double vaccinated. Joy Daniel says, if I lost my vaccine card, where do I go to get another card? Yikes. Anybody watching me now, the minute you get that vaccine card, copy it, photocopy it three times. Keep one at home. Give one to your significant other. Keep one at another location other than your wallet, and then you got a shot. The answer right now, Joy, is I don't have an answer for that. Because where you were vaccinated was only a temporary site. However, they probably had to report it to the Department of Health in the city where you live. So check with them. Let's keep going here. J.E. Kilgore says, I would never thought to have called the airline. By the way, I researched and booked everything online. Really? Let me explain something. And I want to be serious about this. I know why so many of you book online. It's easy to do. You can do it at 3 o'clock in the morning in your bathroom. God forbid you don't have to talk to anybody or even have a conversation. But what you're seeing on your screen on your computer at home in terms of the inventory that's available to you is not what the airline sees on their computer or your travel agent, what they see on their computer. Completely different set of inventory. How many of you go online to book a ticket, say, and you'd see there, oh my God, only three left at this price? You really believe that? No, it's only three left in the allocation of tickets that the airline or other travel provider gave that particular website. Doesn't mean there are people hanging on the wings. Look, I know you're addicted to the web. I get it. I'm addicted to the web too, but I always pick up the phone and call. What are you gonna lose? Okay, let's keep going here. Carol says, hi from Louisville, Kentucky. I can't wait to see the strip with the president when it airs on PBS. Thank you, Carol. By the way, it'll also be available on Amazon Prime and Apple Plus, so you'll be able to see all of them that we've done over the last 20 years. Okay. Wow, here's one from April. Enterprise Rent-A-Car called me today and verified my reservation. And you think that's good news? No, April, it means they verified your reservation. Until you're sitting behind the wheel, leaving the lot with your rental car, it means nothing. You still need to call the local location where you're picking up the car and have, here it comes again, a conversation with that agent whose name you're gonna get down, first and last name, their date of birth, their favorite color, their first sexual experience, I don't care. Just make sure you have a confirming conversation and find out who's gonna be on duty in the time window that you're coming to get the car. I'll feel a whole lot better when you have that conversation, okay? Okay, Elizabeth says hello from Los Angeles. Melissa says hello from Smoky Reno. Yeah, I'm so sorry to hear what's going on out there in the Tahoe area. As a fireman, as you know, I'm a fireman in New York. It's terrible to see what's happened in Greece and it's Turkey and in California and now Lake Tahoe and other parts of California. It's a mess. And I just send all my best wishes to the firefighters out there, because when these fires are burning and they're moving at about 2.5 miles per hour, that may not seem very fast to you. In firefighter terminology, that is like the Indianapolis 500, and it's very tough to fight. And let's just hope for cooler days, rain, and more support for the firefighters. Okay, here we are. Hello from Southern California, from Angela. Do I think it's wise to go to Morocco during Christmas? Are you vaccinated? Are you gonna wear a mask? Are you gonna act responsibly? Did you check with your doctor? Doctor says yes, I say yes. Okay, here we go. Joy Daniels said, are the travel and adventure shows going live anytime soon? They are. In fact, the very first one's gonna be in Dallas this month. I'll be speaking there in a couple of days. That's September 12th, I'll be speaking at the Dallas Travel and Adventure Show. So I hope I'll see you there. Okay, where are we now? Oh. Okay, hi from Portland, from Karen. Terry Reed says, can't wait to see the Tanzania broadcast. Of course, last week, as Terry well knows, was the Temecula broadcast. Okay. Gail wants to know, is there any country that you have not been to but want to someday? Oh, yeah. I've been lucky. There are 196 countries in the world if you go by the UN count. That changes, by the way. I've been to 152 of them. I got another 44 to go. I don't have a bucket list. My list is all the places I've just never been. That should be your list as well. Otherwise, bucket lists are misleading and deceiving. Trust me. So the answer to your question, Gail, is I got another 44 to go, but I'm not in a race. I'm not trying to check off a box on my list. I may never get to those other 44. I may go back to many more of the 152 I've been to, but I have no complaints and no regrets. Hello from Jane Ubell in Stanford. Hello, Jane. Hello from Houston. When does the Travel Detective premiere? Well, that's our season 7. I believe it'll be this fall. If you check our website, petergreenberg.com, it'll start to list very soon when the episodes will start airing again. And then we're already starting to shoot season 8, so we're rocking and rolling. Lisa with a piece of trivia that most people don't know. Where's the distinction of Zanzibar? It wasn't just the movie that Bob Hope and Bing Crosby didn't make. You know who was born there? And they don't make a big deal out of it there, but I know, and Lisa knows, Freddie Mercury. How about that? And Stonetown it is. Lisa wants to know, is this live program the same time weekly? I believe not. How do I get notified? Well, listen to this. We try to do it every Thursday at noon Eastern time, except when I'm traveling. So let me give you a heads up. Next week, I'll be traveling back from Tanzania. So it will not be a week from today. It will be noon Eastern time, a week from tomorrow. And it's a very special show as we acknowledge and commemorate the 20th anniversary of 9/11. Lots of things to talk about, good, bad, and ugly, but in any case, important things to discuss, and we'll do that next week. Hey, let's go right to the photo of the week while I got you. This is an interesting one. Let's put it up there on the screen. It's coming. There it is. All right. Where is it? Anyone want to know? Want me to tell you? All right. First of all, it was taken by Pauline Laxon, and it's a New York photo near Ithaca. Anybody going to Cornell knows exactly where this photo is. And she was hanging out with the Tohannock Falls. I hope I got it right. Tohannock Falls. And they were there in Ithaca to move their daughter into her dorm at Cornell University. They snapped this shot. Pauline, thanks for sending it. Lots of great waterfalls in New York State. People don't know that, but they have them. And that's one of them up there in Ithaca. Let's go to some of the questions you sent in earlier this week. Here's one from Sarah. Is the EU going to close its borders to Americans? Absolutely not. What can be done about the damages to wheelchairs? I need to take my walker. Can I take it onto the plane? If your walker can collapse, the answer is yes. In many cases, the walkers can actually fit in the overhead compartments. But on some commuter flights, nothing fits in the overhead compartment, and you have to gate check it. My suggestion is to get some bungee cords and wrap it carefully, then chances are it won't come out looking like it just got run over on the 405. Okay, here's one from Emily. Is it already time to book holiday travel? When do you advise booking for Thanksgiving and Christmas? That would have been now. Don't wait. Remember, no news bulletins there. We know on the Wednesday is before Thanksgiving. We know the Friday before Christmas. And for any of you planning December or January travel, you know the bad day is anything after December 15th, the prices zoom up. So if you want to do any December travel, come back before the 15th. Or remember, there are two dead weeks every year in the U.S. It's the week following Thanksgiving. You know what Thanksgiving is. It's your obligatory dysfunctional family get-together. You know it. So the week after that, everybody's recovering from that. Nobody's traveling. And the next dead week is the week right after New Year's because everybody's recovering. Parents, listen up. Do what my parents did with me. Go to the teachers, get an extra credit assignment, and take your kids out of school the week after Thanksgiving and the week after New Year's. Then the family gets a vacation at a very reasonable price. And no lines, no crazies, no, I mean, it's the best way to do it. I'm the king of the extra credit assignment. Thank you, Mom and Dad. Okay. Oh, Leslie wants to know, I saw your photo with Lionel Richie. How do you know him? Well, for many, many years, I was a correspondent for Newsweek. I covered music for Newsweek, among everything else, ranging from Watergate to Patty Hearst to Gary Gilmore to Howard Hughes. Yes, I'm dating myself, but I did. And Lionel and I became friends years and years ago. And then, as you saw in my Facebook post, it's just uncanny. I will be landing in the middle of Abu Dhabi and hear my name called out, and it's Lionel. Or in Hong Kong, or in the middle of nowhere. And I never see him in LA. He never sees me in New York. But we do catch up all along. And in fact, as I also said in my Facebook post, his next concert coming up is in Las Vegas, right around the corner, about a week from today or tomorrow, I think September 10th at the Wynn or the Encore, I believe. Okay, let's go back to some more of your questions. Alex, hello from Costa Rica. My good pal Mary Jane says thanks. Hi from California. Okay, why aren't there cops inside the planes? Catalina wants to know that. Okay, well, there are on selected flights. They're called FAMs. Federal Air Marshals. Here's the problem. They only put them on what they consider high-risk flights. You know what a high-risk flight is? Any flight going to Washington, D.C., our capital. Some flights to New York. Some flights to Chicago. But there are not enough of them, number one. And number two, you always know who they are. They're always the guy sitting in 3B wearing the Dockers pants, reading the Tom Clancy novel, and trying to blend. How stupid is that? What we need is not plainclothes FAMs. We need uniformed FAMs sitting in the jump seat next to the cockpit facing the passengers. Show of force. Why not? I mean, everybody's going to know we got one on board. The problem is you don't often have one on board. Not only that, if you want to know if you have one on board, stand at the gate before your flight leaves and see who they're pre-boarding. You see a guy with a pair of Dockers clutching that Tom Clancy book wearing a fanny pack. Da-da! It's a FAM. Right? Could that be any more stupid and obvious? Okay. All right. Greg says, if it takes 5 months to get a new passport, what do you do in the meantime? Go to the library and check out a whole lot of books. I'm not kidding. It's a mess. We are citizens of the United States. We have the freedoms that we think we have, one of which is the freedom to travel. We are being denied the freedom to travel because of bureaucratic mix-ups, mess-ups, and stupidity at the State Department that have nothing to do with pandemic anymore. Let's go fix that, all right? By the way, deny our elected representatives a passport for 5 months and see how fast they're going to fix it. How about that? Okay, Michael wants to know my thoughts on a trip to Mauritius in December. I love Mauritius. You fly right into Port Louis. And December is a magic month over there. So the answer is yes. But if you're going to go to Mauritius, do a side trip to the island of Reunion, also out there in the Indian Ocean. What a great way to bookend a trip. And if you're flying from Los Angeles, how are you going to get there? One of three ways, actually. Through Istanbul, that's right. Turkish Airlines flies to more international destinations than any other airline in the world. Or through Dubai with Emirates. And I think Etihad is also going through Abu Dhabi. That's how you do it. That's the easiest way and the fastest way. All right, let's keep going here. Ju says hello from Japan. Okay, hi from Triangle Lake, Oregon. That's Maridel. Let me go back down here. I don't want to miss anybody, guys. But let me also suggest to you that you can catch the radio show this Saturday. Very interesting show, by the way. And of course, that's 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. Eastern time. You can also log on to petergreenberg.com and see the radio icon, hit it. We stream it live if you can't find a station in your local market. You can follow me on Instagram. That's at Peter Greenberg, or on Twitter at Peter S. Greenberg. We mentioned Eye on Travel on CBS. And of course, stay tuned early next year for a one-hour PBS special, The Royal Tour of Tanzania, part of our continuing global travel series with heads of state around the world. It's now about 7:45 in the evening here in Dar es Salaam. We've had a pretty long day shooting with the president. So if you'll excuse me, I'm going to practice globalization and go get some sushi in Tanzania. Yes, it's pretty good. So we'll see you next week, everybody. Remember, next week, this particular show is on Friday the 10th, not Thursday the 9th, at noon Eastern time. I'll see you there. Continue to email me your questions. We'll answer it online or on the radio show this weekend. Bye-bye, everybody, and thanks for watching.